Welcome back. Sorry to leave you hanging like that, but you know, I gotta keep you on a short leash here, otherwise you stop watching. That's what all the statistics tell me. If you're somebody who watches all the way to the end of my videos, I think there's gonna be prizes soon. Hang on in there, it won't be in this video series. So I'm not gonna don't be looking for that. Don't just be scrolling all the way to the end, looking for me to offer you something free when I can just offer you a free P52 Merlin for creating your own starter package and using my star code to claim your free P52 and giving me one too. If you want to give it to somebody else, I don't care, but just if that's the one free thing that I offer to you and you don't have to give it to me, you can give it to somebody else and you still get that free thing. So there you go, there's a free ship this time. So as we jump into this, keep a few things in mind. Obviously these opinions are my own, they are limited to my experience flying these ships. There are other ships out there that are similar. Other people are going to feel like theirs is the greatest ever. Reliant Tana people are one of those people. I don't get it. I've flown all of the ships in free fly events or through other means. All of the ones that are commonly available to players. Obviously, I haven't flown an Idris. I'm not shelling out that kind of money. And these will reflect my experiences. So if you have different ones, I still would love to hear them. And without further ado, let's jump in and show you what's going on. All right, so you picked the Mustang Alpha Starter Pack. That's why you're here. Let's jump to what you should buy next. The Freelancer. Now, I had originally said that you could be doing the Nomad, the Cutty Black, the Freelancer Max. And had left out the Freelancer. I thought that this was a stupid, useless ship until I was starkly chided for misreading the weapon loadout here. Because these pilot weapons here on when you go to Urkel do not show as pilot weapons. I don't know why. But I just totally misread it. I didn't realize that these gimbaled weapons were pilot controlled. They obviously, I should have known that. Anyway, great ship. Exceedingly maneuverable, less weight. It only costs a little bit more in real world dollars. If you do want to go this route and just buy this ship, this is totally a good option. And it hauls more cargo than the Cutty Black. Now, it is going to come in a little bit richer. So you're going to be sitting here at 1.7 million AEUC. That's going to take you a hot minute to get. But once you do, you're going to be able to take double quant hauls back. Okay, that's important for you. If you want to buy a prospector instead of a rock. And that's going to be in my next recommendation. Getting a little ahead of myself. Just know that this is a good all-rounder ship. You can do multi-crew with it. You have multiple beds so your crew can sleep with you. You can bed log. And while it could use some fixes, the fixes that it needs are not as stark to me as the ones the Cutty Black needs. It doesn't just fall to pieces. The one dumb thing about this is that you can't forward lock the turret. So if you are flying with a three-year-old, as I like to do, my son and I love to play together. I'll just forward lock his turret. You can't actually forward lock it, but I'll just like keep him. He knows letters now, and he'll just press the letter C to center it. Just a quick tip for those of you who are using turrets: you press C, it'll center you to the same focus point as the pilot. I'll keep him honed on me. That way, when we're team firing on someone, he hits exactly where I'm aiming. Having him try to hit something else is impossible. We'll wait another year or two for that one. So just know this is a thing. That's the one downside I'd say about the ship. If you are looking for that, get something different. I think there are a lot of good team fight ships, Hurricane Scorpius. We'll cover those later, but this one just works pretty well if you have adult friends. All right, so. Other options in this class though include the Nomad. Excellent ship. I'm going to recommend this as its own starter package right now in the next video, as it is just as cheap as an Adventure is. I mean, it's like $1 more, but you're getting 24 SCU. It's not a full load of quant, but it's enough to make you good money if you just want to. And you're usually getting some inert materials, especially if you're just quick mining quant and not trying to min max each individual rock, which is the wrong way to do quant, by the way. If you're doing that, you're a moron because you're just being needlessly tedious about a task that the time value of money just doesn't doesn't equal that type of mining, right? So if you're team mining something like with a mole and you can just like blitz a bunch of rocks and only scoop up 100% and do it all at once, that can be a good way to do it. But otherwise, it's just not a good way to mine, in my opinion. If you're just trying to do it to relax and chill out, then great. But this is not a video about just getting into play Star Citizen and not worrying about anything else. This is for people who want to move their way up the ladder, get ships, and try out all of the different game modes. So just before you levy your criticism, please keep it in mind that and say, hey, look, I just think this is that people should let go of that. That's fine. Anyway, this is allegedly supposed to come with Tractor Beam. Doesn't have it. This does have three size threes. Most importantly, though, you can fit a Gray Cat rock in the back and you don't have to open doors for it. It is the best for rock mining because it's small enough to fit in places. Yes, you can fit a rock into a cutty. Not a cutty, sorry, a cutter. Why did they have to name them? Like, seriously? Anyway, a Drake cutter, that's like the single seater, but it's super janky and it's really terrifying and it's a pain to get it in and out. So that technically is an option for you. Nomad is the best option, okay? So that's why I think Nomad is my number one backup choice to the Freelancer. It also fights pretty well. The three size, is it size ones or size twos? Nope. Yeah, no. Size twos. This isn't true. With a single size three gun. Oh, no. That's true. It is one size three and two size twos. That's right. Yeah. Okay, yeah. So this is actually, it's pretty nice. So you got three size three little weapons there, so I think you can unmount these ones. Anyway, it's a little bit of a complex ship for weapons. It's like basically about the same as a Titan for fighting, but just not as much hull. I think it has, either way, it's about the same as a Titan, but it's not as maneuverable and it's a bigger hitbox. Just keep that in mind. Cutlass Black, same fighting prowess as the Freelancer. The only thing that you get with the Cutty that you don't get with the Freelancer is like actually modular VTOL mode. Technically all ships have VTOL mode where it reroutes power to your vertical thrusters, even if the engines don't realign themselves, but your main engines do realign here. Downside is those engines are made to realign, so they fall off real quick. Like real quick. And you're just screwed in combat. You can only fit one and a half. Loads of quant in this one, so not a good one. I just realized that because of an error that they had, Mercury, the MSR was the loaner vehicle for the Cutty Black, not the Freelancer, which is kind of hilarious. I don't know why they don't give the Freelancer for the Cutty Black. They just felt bad, I guess. But like the Mercury Star Runner doesn't really have good pilot control of it. Anyway, now I'm getting distracted, but the pilot gets, yeah, just two size threes. So you get like half the weaponry that you do on the Cutty Black and a much bigger profile ship. Anyway, it'll be cool when data running's in the game, but again, I don't sell future content. You do get 114 SEU off the ship. This one is not recommended, though, because it's 5 million AEUC, which is a total and ridiculous ripoff. All right. Last but not least in this category is Freelancer Max. I think this ship is trash. Other people are going to complain that I didn't include it, though. This one does carry almost double what the Freelancer carries and at only a little bit of a premium. So you're getting a lot more stuff fit in here. And the guns can hold some stuff off. Some people just claim if you swap it into VTOL mode and you use boost, you can get around and hit stuff. An arrow with even a moderately skilled pilot will eat you alive. So, and in the current meta where people are preying on cargo in team fights, I can't in good conscience recommend this ship because you are going to fill it up and you are going to lose all that money. So, but just know this is on here. Some people might want it. You do get the extra shield generator over oh no, they're both two size twos. Yeah, you don't even get extra shields. Yeah, sorry. Every time I look at it and go back through, I'm just stunned at how terrible the ship is. So yeah, if you got an extra size 2 or a size 1, size 3, I think would make more sense for a freelancer, then it would be more palatable. But until then, it's just not. So that rounds out what you buy next, okay? You want your all-rounder, cargo hauler, rock hauler, fun ship, and you probably want to save up enough money from doing bounties and other activities where you can go out and get yourself a rock. Now, rock is going to be your first real introduction to mining. It has gotten better. You can now share storage between characters. And so you're able to dump your whole rock mine storage onto a ship. That ship can fly back, turn in the money, bank it, come back, come get you. And then you can do it with a team this way, and or just one person, if there's just two of you, and you can go back and forth and make some decent money working as a team mining Hat Mine like this. And there are a few different moons that you can mine. Those are remote or collector. So there you go, the rock. This one only costs 172,000. It's super cheap to rent for one day. It's just 3,440, 3,440. Just really, really, really easy to do. You don't need to swap out anything on the thing. I do recommend getting into a full suit. Like one of the negative 140 degree suits where you're not going to run into overheating or freezing issues. So rock is the recommended mining ship for this build. I'm not recommending the Prospector. It is a little bit more finicky. Note that you can buy one if you want to, but it's not in this recommended chain because you can still go out and rock mine and have the same relaxing experience. It's even more fun with other people, and you get to fly around and do and practice landing, taking off. I recommend that people do this before you do prospector mining. Don't just go for the gold because somebody said it's worth more money. It's pretty close. They're very similar. We did time trials on these ones. If you want to look for those videos, just look up my playlist on how to get AUC time trials. So this one is the recommended one. Well, don't get the Rock DS trash. It's so stupid. One of them extracts and one of them sucks up all the ore, and you have to have two people to use it. The other, like the second person's thing, doesn't have oxygen, so they'll suffocate after a certain amount of time. It's just ridiculous. Okay, it's like on in so many levels, it's the stupidest shouldn't exist ship in the whole game, in my opinion. Okay. So that's the rock. Next thing you're gonna want to do. So right now you're getting all rounder. You can do cargo. You can do some fighting. Now what you really need to do is have a good, great ship for doing bunkers. And there's one key element I think that you need for doing bunker missions. And there's one ship that does it really well, especially for the money. And that's the C8R Pisces Rescue. If you get injured with a minor tier 3 injury, you can go in, and tier 3s are the lowest, by the way. So if you have a tier 2 or a tier 1, that this will like keep you from dying, but you got to go back to a real hospital bed so that you could get to a real hospital where you can get tier 1 medical care. But this is how people can basically like use these as ambulances for other people. This enables a whole other type of gameplay where you can go do medical rescue missions to save other people. You can bring med guns, or tractor beams, haul them back to your ship, drop them on the med bed, take care of them, get them so they don't die, fly them back to a hospital where they can get fully healed, and do all kinds of stuff that's kind of similar to that. So it also comes with a little fridge stocked with med pens and food. And one of the best things, if you're going to be chaining for multiple hours bounty missions, whenever you lay on the med bed, even though it's just a tier 3, it's going to refill both of your health and your sustenance. So that's your food and water bars. So you won't die from those. Note that like you don't, whenever you drink water, it gives you a hydration effect. So it makes it so you don't get thirsty as quickly. But if you just like pop in the bed real quick between missions, you're good to go. If even after a couple of missions, you can also just grab some food from the fridge and tide yourself over that way if that's just getting agitating to you. So, but if you take a shot to the leg, after you've cleared the bunker, you're not bleeding out and it's just some damage to you, just go and lay in the bed, no problem. Easy peasy lemon squeezy. This one only costs a little over 400,000. Now the regular Pisces is stupid. The Expedition Pisces, I think, costs a little bit less than this one. It comes in at 400,000. So you're just paying an extra 50,000. You do lose out on two of the weapons that comes with the Pisces Expedition, but both of them are just paper tigers. They're fun to fly. They can kill stuff, but you are risking quite a lot. Note that the Expedition also comes with four SCU cargo. So, that's a choice you can make. This one does not come with any cargo space. So you do get 4,000 micro SCU storage space on this one, but that's just basically to store some guns and a couple of snacks kind of thing. So don't go trying to do anything other than bunker missions and like some really quick and easy package delivery missions. Oh, one other thing I was going to talk about this one though. Combat speed is 164, so this is recommended. I think max speed is around 1200. I don't believe that this one is. Oh, it's the combat speed is 142, max speed is 1150 on the X. So this one is 164 versus 142. So another reason I recommend it is just because it's worth just for the time it saves you flying between bunker missions. I did a whole review on the ship. Go and watch that video. If you want to hear more about why specifically I like this ship, just note that this is what I would recommend to you if you are trying to get into bunkers, do package delivery missions, or anything that's just like quick missions where you're flying somewhere, grabbing something, doing something with it. There's a whole bunch of those missions, illicit and not. So this one is just a great all-rounder ship for that, and it's just under 500,000. So it's just a few chained bounty missions, and bing, bada, boom, you've got it unlocked. Now there is an alternative option in this space. Okay, there is, and that is the Cutty Red. But I've kind of skipped over it on this list just because the Cutty Red is 1.8 million, so I don't really think it really fits in there. The last thing that I want you to do is get a ship that's gonna just make you money. And the Retaliator Bomber, if you've been playing the game long enough to buy it, you'll probably have ERT missions unlocked. Those are the highest level bounty hunting missions. And if you have those ones unlocked and you can go grind money doing it this way, this is the best, most consistent, least buggy, super fun way to make money in the game. I have multiple videos of me doing this. I cannot recommend to you enough how much fun the Retaliator Bomber is. It is a tank. I think it has the most health of any ship in the game. The shields are a little flippy floppy, right? This is just two. It has two size twos, just like the Freelancer and the Cutty Black do. So, it's not like the shields are super thick and gonna get you through a fire, but you can. It has more health than a hammerhead. Okay, so and I've done this frequently. This is like not something I've done once as a Hail Mary. Like this was easier than watching Adventure One try to dumb fire a torpedo into an Idris. Okay, I just ram them. Just ram the hammerhead. When you're all out of torpedoes or your torpedo bay doors get shot so they don't open, that doesn't need to stop you. You gun it. You save up your boost and you just punch your shields all the way to the forward of the ship and you just slam right into that, right behind the big bow shape of its head, right into that supple, unctuous, frothy middle. And you just hit that with all the force you have. Okay, this thing, but seriously though, this thing won't die. Like, try rolling it around on the ground and it will take quite a while to blow up. Another fun thing about the ship is the turrets are amazing and it has great sight lines on all of them. You can see here one on top, one on bottom, just below the pilot, just behind the pilot. Sleeping quarters is up here by this other turret. You climb up a ladder to get into it, and then the captain has a captain quarters right in here. This is, it has not changed for me, my recommended ship for everyone on Pledge. Okay, so the standalone Pledge for this is $275 on War Bond is 260, but don't do that. Okay, this is again buy ships that they have in the game, and what they have in the game right now is the Retaliator Bomber. What they don't have in the game right now, and I'm trying to see if it even is available anywhere on here. What they don't have available in the game right now is just the Retaliator base. Okay? And what the Retaliator base is just a concept ship of the Retaliator Bomber where you can replace those internal torpedo sections with living quarters, a dropship section, just a cargo hold, and all of these. This is going to be cool. I'm actually very much looking forward to my ship turning into a modular ship. But what it is right now is an incredible freaking deal. Okay, this is 150 standalone. They only do it in time limited sales, so just make sure you get it when it comes available. But this is, and I kid you not, the same thing right now, because you're getting the other ship on loan because this one doesn't exist. So you, if you are spending $275 or even $260, I'm sorry. All right. So your pledge value, even though this is still pretty good, 14,000 AUC per dollar is still pretty good pledge value. This one is like, does it even give it? It doesn't even give one. This is like double that. It's like 30,000. Not, and that's not it. Okay, I have a whole separate video on this one. You also get a Gladiator, which, you know, all people are going to be like, Gladiator's stupid. It's all overpriced. Blah, 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 blah. It has good guns, has good missiles, and it has a turret that's really easy for a three-year-old to get into, aim forward, and shoot people. These two together are just all the fun I need in Star Citizen. And I am so glad I paid the money for it. Okay, people are going to be like, no, experience the game. Go zero to hero. You can do that. But not when you're a dad who has limited amounts of time to play, okay? I don't have the patience to just grind my way through this game every single patch. Now, if I started out in the game and I built up an inventory of ships that didn't go away, that'd be cool. As an aside, maybe I'm going to make a video about this where we'll like dig really deeply. Let me know if this is something you want to see. But I think that we should really recommend to CIG that if you are beta testing, alpha testing their game, you should keep something between patches, right? There is no incentive for you to play 318. Really, there's not. And there should be, because you are play testing a game that they want to sell for hundreds of millions of dollars. You are providing valuable services to them. I don't want to speak about other games, other groups, other things, but there are other companies and games that have people and give people free games, like free, not just in beta testing mode, the full unlocked game for beta testing their game and providing feedback. I'm not asking them to give us ships in our hangar necessarily, and I'm not asking that. I think that maybe you should have a certain amount in your bank that you carry over that you can spend flexibly going forward, or maybe just have it so I unlock a ship that's stupid from that patch, right? Like if everyone I'm just like unlocking the M50, you know, that's fine. Or an Ursa Rover, you know, or a Steve. I don't care. Just incentivize me with something to keep playing between patches. Let me know what you guys think about that down in the comments down below. Coming back to my to rounding this out though, what the Retaliator is going to do for you is open up the universe of every other ship. Okay, so what I've done here is given you a path to be able to do every single game mode so that you can play the game, have fun, and not get burnt out by earning the money to earn the Retaliator so that you can spend 30 minutes of gaming once a day, once every couple of days to rack in $250,000, $250,000 AUC. And once you have that money every day, you're going to very quickly add that up and get to these other ships in the game that you really want. You're going to see those on the other lists that I have. But for now, let's just stop here. All in this. Oh, there is one other thing I was going to say. There is another option here. So I did, for those of you who don't love my fanboying, the Eclipse is the other option. A couple of things about the Eclipse. Now, it has one pro. The torpedo bay doors don't get slammed shut. So if you're riding a Retaliator and you're doing a triple bounty, like a triple head, I recommend doing them on four, okay? You get a single ERT, and then if that one completes and the other one's still in the rings of yellow right after you got out of Grim Hex, then you do another single ERT, and then you do another single ERT, and then you do your triple outside the rings of yellow. So you got those four that you've done in rings of yellow, and then you do the other two off somewhere else. That's all six of your torpedoes, and then that's going to get you the money. Now, I often usually recommend you do those in four. So you can try to min-max it that way, but I'd say do only do four. So do the starter, then do the triple, okay? And then you can do two extras. Sometimes your torpedoes will miss. Sometimes you will shoot them at the wrong target. Sometimes the target won't die. Sometimes your torpedo bays will get slammed shut because you'll get shot or you'll bump into an asteroid. That doesn't really happen to the Eclipse. Downside is Eclipse only has three of those torpedoes. Now, why do I recommend so strongly the Retaliator over the Eclipse? Now, one nice thing about the Eclipse does have two pilot-controlled size one blasters. I mean, they're size ones, so don't. Oh no, they're size twos. Okay, they're 227. Although the damage output of a size one versus size two is very negligible. It is technically a damage difference. So you are getting size twos. And you can kill stuff with those. You can do like very light, like easy, very low bounties with those. So if you wanted to start off the game with just an Eclipse, you totally could be very doable. A couple of reasons not to do that. One, pledge value is atrocious. The pledge value on an Eclipse is less than the Retaliator Bomber, which again is a stupid ship to buy. And you also get a Gladiator Loaner on. The Eclipse, you don't get the loaner. It costs you as much money on War Bond, let alone standalone. I don't understand what their thinking is here. I just like, why would you so negatively encourage play or like discourage players from having this ship? I don't get it. It's a really sleek ship. It's fun to fly. It's Aegis, just like the Retaliator is. So you have like the same voice, Aegis. Welcome to Aegis Dynamics. Whenever you get in the ship, the HUDs are good, probably a little bit better than the Retaliator. It's more fun to fly than the Retaliator. Retaliator is clunky. It is a heavy ship, and you feel it flies a little like the Connies. So it's not bad like the Corsair, but it's not great like a friggin' Razor. Okay, so just kind of hedge your bets that way. This one is a size too small instead of a size, I think a size four. Yeah, size four large. So those are kind of the comparisons, but even in the universe, this one just costs you 500, only 500,000 less than the bomber does. I guess technically it's like 5,041. 500,041. Either way, it's not a whole lot. Save up for the other one. You get a multi-crew ship. It lasts a lot longer, and you can do, like I said, those four chained up to six chained bounties, which is gonna get you so much money so quickly, and it's so easy to do. And if you're just doing that, and then just blowing up, going back, questing at the terminal, logging off, and/or doing bunker missions after that, just to chill out. That's a great way to play the game. Anyway, this is why I'm breaking this up into three separate videos, because I knew that I would just go on and on and on and talk about all these details, because the details do matter. I don't want to just give you a video that's just like, bing, 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 here are the things, do this, mindless drones. Come on, sheeple, because you're all smart people. You're playing a game that requires has a significant learning curve, and you want to mix and match and make it your own. That's why I'm giving you backup options and trying to explain my thought process to you. What I'm also doing is opening myself up for criticism, and I want to hear it. I want to hear all of you fans of some ship out there that's going to change my mind just like the Freelancer did. Okay? I want to hear it. I want to hear what you think the starter player who's just getting into the game should do to try out all of the different game modes. But I think this is, in my opinion, the best starting path for somebody who only wants to spend $40 on the game. Let me know what you think in the comments down below. Until next time, good luck out there. Have some fun. Keep on gaming. Bye for now.